Detroit Diesel is arguably the underdog in the history of diesel engines in the U.S. It was started later than both Cummins and Caterpillar, but as you'll see in this episode of Diesel History, Detroit quickly made a name for itself in the over-the-road truck market. Thanks for patiently waiting for this video. It is finally here, so let's get started. Detroit Diesel is the last of the great three diesel engine manufacturers when it comes to the North American over-the-road market. It is the youngest, being started officially in 1938 rather than the much older Caterpillar and Cummins companies, who were in their infancies during the 1920s. Detroit's origins really begin in 1930 when General Motors acquired Winton Engines, who made marine engines, and Electromotive Engineering, a manufacturer of diesel locomotive engines. Because of the early success of GM's locomotive engine business, the company began plans for a facility to manufacture smaller diesel power plants for over-the-road trucks. In January of 1938, General Motors started production of engines at the new Detroit Diesel Engine Division. In doing so, General Motors also renamed the Winton Engine Facility to the Cleveland Diesel Engine Division. Detroit's first engine, the Series 71, is one of the most legendary power plants ever crafted. Its name, the Series 71, refers to the cubic inch displacement of one cylinder in a Series 71 engine. During its first iteration, the Series 71 was a two-cycle engine line. For those not aware, two-cycle diesel engines are incapable of drawing in combustion air. Therefore, a gear-driven root-style blower was fitted to all Series 71 engines. Depending on the application, a Series 71 would have 1, 2, 4, or 6 cylinders fashioned in an inline configuration. Because of this simple design, the Series 71 was lightweight, and the new Detroit Diesel Engine Division built over 57,982 Series 71 engines in 1943 alone. Nearly all of these engines were put into immediate military use across the Southern Pacific and Europe. Detroit Diesel grew rapidly during the Second World War and employed over 4,300 people by 1945. 1,300 of those were women. After the defeat of Nazi Germany and the dropping of two atomic weapons on mainland Japan, the Axis powers surrendered and World War II came to a close. Many of the first Detroit Series 71 engines are scattered around the world, rusting away on Pacific islands and French countryside. What you may not know, though, is the Soviet Union produced many 471 and 671 lookalikes during and after the war. Back to 1945, Detroit released their second engine line, the Series 110. Just like the Series 71, 110 referred to the cubic displacement of a single cylinder in a Series 110 engine. Unlike the Series 71, the Series 110 was almost exclusively made in a six-cylinder configuration. The Series 110 was marketed as a more powerful alternative to the Series 71 and was used in construction equipment, rail cars, and power generators. Though Detroit Diesel's background was in locomotive and marine applications, the dwindling use of the railroad after World War II pushed Detroit into a new market. Over-the-road trucks were taking over as the most efficient and versatile way to transport large quantities of supplies. And in 1956, the Interstate Highway System was signed into law with the Federal Aid Highway Act by Dwight D. Eisenhower. The commercial truck manufacturers gladly accepted Detroit engines into the market. Detroit entering the over-the-road truck market was huge because, at the time, Cummins engines produced well over 50% of all power plants in over-the-road trucks. Their 855 cubic inch inline six-cylinder NT series could be found in tens of thousands of trucks around the world. Learn more about the NT series in part 2 of our Cummins history video. In order to compete with the raw power Cummins was producing, Detroit developed their first 71 series motor in a V configuration. The new 6V71 was joined quickly by 8, 12, 16, and 24-cylinder bigger brothers. These new V-configuration engines were placed in buses, construction equipment, over-the-road trucks, motorhomes, and more. Because of the additional cylinders, new configuration, and in some cases, turbocharging, the power levels of the new Series 71 V-motors increased significantly over their predecessors. Interchangeable parts and easy-to-work-on power plants also contributed to Detroit's rise to prominence in over-the-road trucks. Another engine series that debuted in 1957 was the Series 53. 53 cubic inches a cylinder, this engine line featured 3, 4, 6, 8, and 12 cylinder models, all in a V configuration. These smaller power plants had great thermal properties and could operate at maximum load for long periods of time, which was why they were used in marine and generator applications. Cleveland Diesel, which was discussed a few minutes ago, was moved to General Motors Electromotive Division in 1962. This left Detroit Diesel Engine Division as the only remaining partner of GM's Diesel Division. General Motors Diesel Division is eventually absorbed into Detroit Diesel in 1965. Early the next year in 1966, Detroit Diesel released their Series 149 for workboat, pushboat, and 100-ton plus mining truck applications. Like the rest of the Detroit Diesel engine lineup of this time, this engine series was considered naturally aspirated, though a root-style blower was used to scavenge the two-stroke power plant. Detroit would add turbocharging and intercooling later to boost top-end models to well over 3,000 horsepower. Getting back to the 71V series of Detroit engines, with their multiple updates including turbocharging and intercooling, were well represented against the likes of Caterpillar and Cummins during the 1960s. Many popular truck builders of the time, including Kenworth, used Detroit 6V71 and 8V71s in their lineup. Watch our History of Kenworth Trucks video for more details on Kenworths. Another big change in Detroit's corporate structure occurred in 1970 when General Motors consolidated their Allison Transmission and Gas Turbine Division with Detroit Diesel. The result? Detroit Diesel Allison Division. 1974 marked a huge shift in Detroit Diesel's approach to building engines because of the energy crisis. The Series 92, nicknamed the Fuel Squeezers, was introduced and reportedly was between 10 and 20% more efficient than similar power plants of the time. During these fuel-sipping years of the mid to late 70s, Detroit Diesel did very well against the biggest player in the diesel engine market, Cummins. In fact, Detroit had carved out 30% of the diesel truck market by 1980. In order to grab more of that market, Detroit started to research four-stroke diesel engines. The result of their research is the famous Detroit 60 series. The Detroit 60 series, which was released in 1987, was cleaner, more fuel-efficient, and more popular than any other over-the-road truck power plant of the time. It was the only truck engine of the 1980s to employ both an overhead camshaft and a drive-by-wire electronic control system. Initial Series 60 units were six cylinders with a displacement of 677 cubic inches or 11.1 liters. Larger 12.7 liter Series 60 motors were also available. A joint venture in 1988 with Penske Corporation created a new namesake for Detroit. Detroit Diesel Corporation was formed, and former race car driver and racing magnate Roger Penske sat as CEO through the end of the 80s and into the early 90s. Penske immediately invested in research and development, but the early 90s economic downturn took a toll on Detroit Diesel Corporation. In 1995, the Series 60 officially replaced the Series 71, and 3 years later, in 1998, the 11.1 liter Series 60 power plants were discontinued, leaving only the 12.7 liter Series 60s in production. Because of the great performance of the Series 60 during the late 80s and 90s, Detroit caught the eye of Daimler Chrysler. In 2000, Daimler purchased Detroit Diesel Corporation and incorporated Detroit under a new business division known as Daimler Chrysler Power Systems. During this time period, the Daimler Chrysler Power Systems division employed over 34,000 employees and boasted nearly $7 billion in annual revenue. 1 year later, in 2001, the displacement of their very popular Series 60 engines rose from 12.7 to 14 liters. This rise in displacement also increased power of the Series 60 up to 575 horsepower. The performance increase went over well with drivers, and by 2004, a majority of Series 60 engines were 14 liters. In order to update Detroit Diesel's aging facilities and engine lineup, $350 million was invested into new equipment and research and development. The result of this investment was the DD family of engines, which was released in 2007. The first of the DD lineup, the DD15, is a 15-liter up to 505 horsepower power plant. The new DD lineup is different from the earlier Series 60 line in nearly every single way. Only a few electronic and emissions components were continued from the Series 60 line. Following DD engines included the DD5, DD8, DD13, and DD16. Though the DD line was the flagship engine series for Detroit, the Series 60 was still built and supported during this time. In fact, in 2009, the 1 millionth Series 60 engine rolled off the Detroit assembly line. 1 year later, in 2010, Detroit launched their BlueTech emissions technology. The entire DD lineup of engines received updates to emissions equipment and tuning. In 2012, Detroit produced their 100,000th DD engine platform and introduced their new DT-12 automated manual transmission. The DT-12 and DD-15 integrated powertrain would be released the next year in 2013 with the unveiling of the Cascadia Evolution. Also unveiled in 2013, the first OEM-provided factory-installed telematics program ever, Detroit Connect. Lastly, in 2016, Detroit agreed to pay $28.5 million to resolve EPA violations of the U.S. Federal Clean Air Act that occurred back in 2010. But don't let a couple million dollars in fines dissuade you from the Detroit brand. Detroit's reputation for building world-class engines remains strong in the trucking world. Before you click away, like this video, and if you enjoyed what you watched, check out the rest of our Diesel History series and our new 100 Years of Trucking series. Help us make more truck videos by visiting our website and purchase a Truck History or Jack's Chrome Shop shirt in the online shop. Until next time, guys, I'm Dave from Jack's Chrome, and remember, if your rig don't shine, you don't know Jack.